Election Day 2014. Polls just closed in 13 more states, and voting has ended in more than half the country. I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff. Control of the U.S. Senate hangs in the balance. Republicans need to pick up 6 seats to retake the majority. And tonight they have already won 2 key contests.
The House of Representatives looks to remain in Republican hands. 36 states will elect governors. Those races are so tight, more incumbent governors are at risk of losing this year than any time in the last 5 decades.
Stay with us all night on air and online for analysis and the latest results, plus a special report at 11 p.m. Eastern.
It's election night on the PBS NewsHour.
PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Lincoln Financial, committed to helping you take charge of your life and become your own chief life officer.
BNSF Railway.
And by BAE Systems, inspired work. And with the ongoing support of these institutions.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
It is 9 o'clock in the East, and Republicans are building momentum tonight in their drive to capture control of the U.S. Senate. So far, they have taken 2 of the 6 seats they need. In Arkansas, where Congressman Tom Cotton defeated incumbent Democrat Mark Pryor. And in West Virginia, where Shelley Moore Capito won the seat being vacated by Democratic Senator Jay Rockefeller, who is retiring. A number of key Senate races in Georgia, in North Carolina, Virginia, and New Hampshire all remain too close to call. And we know the polls, Gwen, just closed in several other important states. They're all important, including Colorado, Kansas, and Louisiana. And we want to add, in governor's races, the Democrats have picked up a Republican seat in Pennsylvania, where Tom Wolf defeated incumbent Tom Corbett. However, Republican Asa Hutchinson captured an open seat in Arkansas that had been held by Democrats. So the map is moving around.
They are. And we're hearing a new report tonight from South Dakota as well, Judy. We're Mike Rounds.
We are. Mike Rounds, we can call this one. He was a former governor, but he is now picking up that Senate seat. This is another pickup for the Republicans, defeating Democrat Dick Weiland and former Senator Larry Pressler, a Republican who became a Democrat. And we can also now call yet another state in New Hampshire. Gene Shaheen has won re-election. The Democrats were beginning to sweat that one out, and it's a relief, I know, to find out that she's winning it.
Well, Gene Shaheen beat Scott Brown, who famously ran for Senate and was defeated, was actually a senator in Massachusetts, lost, moved to New Hampshire, challenged the sitting Senator Gene Shaheen, and ran a very strong race in the end.
He sure did. And I just point out that Larry Pressler didn't become a Democrat. He became an independent.
You're right.
He voted. He said he voted for President Obama twice.
That's right.
Just a minor point.
Well, one of the bigger races we've been following tonight was in Kentucky, where Republican leader Mitch McConnell won another term as senator. And, of course, he's a Senate minority leader as well. And if Republicans took over tonight, he would become the Senate majority leader. He was defeated his Democratic challenger, Allison Lundgren Grimes. He spoke to supporters just moments ago at his campaign headquarters in Louisville, telling them they will be heard in Washington.
Difficulty with that audio.
We're having a little bit of problem about that, but we'll turn it around and get it back to you in a moment.
It's coming all the way from Louisville or someplace like that, so maybe that is a problem. We'll get it for you as soon as we can. But Mark, since you corrected me on Larry Pressler, I'm not going to turn to you for the next question. No, we want to be corrected. We want to be right. Mike, let's go back to New Hampshire, though. Michael Gerson, this was a state, again, Democrats thought they were in good shape there, and they were sweating it out.
Well, this is one of the things I'm looking at tonight. It's, can Republicans win away games? Can they win in places out of the South, out of their normal roundhouse here. And New Hampshire, a lot of Republicans had some hopes here, and that's been disappointed. We're looking at North Carolina in that category. We're looking at Iowa and Colorado in that category. That indicates to me a lot about 2016. Can Republicans win in places that purple states, not just red states?
Yeah, well, the question, of course, about that is exactly whether the candidate is the strong one or the challenger is the strong one. As we saw in Kentucky, and actually I think we have that speech from Mitch McConnell, that excerpt, and we're going to take a look at it right now, and then we'll talk about it on the other side.
When you get right down to it, that's what this campaign was really all about. It wasn't about me or my opponent. It was about a government that people no longer trust to carry out its most basic duties, to keep them safe, to protect the border, to provide dignified and quality care for our veterans. A government that can't be trusted to do the basic things because it's too busy focusing on things it shouldn't be focused on at all. A government that's too busy imposing its view of the world on people who don't share that view.
And you know what's interesting about Mitch McConnell is he was dealing in Kentucky with people. We talked to several. I was there this past weekend. Mm-hmm. He was dealing with Democrats who don't like the fact that he doesn't do anything to help the president, Democrats who still like President Obama. But he was also trying to deal, Mark, with some conservatives who remember the role he played in some budget compromises and other the few times there have been a compromise working across the aisle, they saw Mitch McConnell involved in that, and they didn't like it.
Yeah, Mitch McConnell had a primary challenge. It turned out not to be as formidable or as savvy a challenger, but Mitch McConnell dispatched him, a conservative challenger, who ran against him on those very grounds, that he was not a true blue conservative and authentic. And so I think once he got by that, and I'll tell you, the other secret weapon he had in this campaign was Rand Paul.
Yeah.
Rand Paul, who won that Senate seat, just recall, just 4 years ago, is now a national candidate and beat Mitch McConnell's Trey Grayson, Secretary of State, Mitch McConnell's hand-picked Republican nominee, and there was real bitterness at the time. Yeah, but he needed Rand Paul.
I remember when Rand Paul covered that race, when Rand Paul ran for Senate, and Mitch McConnell was not his pal.
No.
And in fact, tame all the way around, which means in some level that Mitch McConnell is a survivor. He gets ahead of the wave.
That's true. It also means that Rand Paul wants establishment credibility. He's, I think, gaining a lot of standing within the party. He wants to run as a more mainstream Republican than his background, which is quite libertarian. So it was a confluence here of the need of Mitch McConnell, but also the need of Rand Paul.
Very interesting survivor politics that were being played in the state of
Absolutely.
Kentucky. So we want to hear now what it is like on the ground in some of the key states we're watching tonight. Hari Srinivasan, as we've been telling you, is in our newsroom. He'll be talking with reporters across the country all night. Hari?
Thanks, Judy. Castration is not typically a word you associate with political success, but in Iowa, Republican State Senator Joni Ernst, the candidate, used experience as a kid on a pig farm and a pledge to cut pork in D.C. to grab some headlines and surge in the polls. Congressman Bruce Bailey is hoping to keep a Democrat in the Senate seat that's being vacated by Tom Harkin, who is retiring. It's considered a must-win for Democrats if they want to keep control of the Senate. O.K. Henderson is news director of Radio Iowa and joins us now from Washington. So I got to ask, this was not a Senate race that was on the map for Democrats to have to defend. Why did this become so close?
Well, two reasons. One, President Obama's popularity in Iowa is below the national average. It's below 40%. Some polls put it as low as 37%, number one. Number two, Bruce Braley had a self-inflicted wound when he was caught on video criticizing Iowa's Republican Senator Chuck Grassley, suggesting that Grassley, if Republicans take control of the United States Senate, will be someone who's not a lawyer who will become chairman of the Judiciary Committee. He had a hard time after that. He's been swimming upstream the whole time because of that and because of President Obama's popularity rating here.
Okay, obviously you're not in Washington. I saw the S-T-O-N at the end and I thought you're in Johnston. But I also want to ask, is gender playing a role in how the voters turn out here, especially when the female candidate is very conservative?
One of the interesting things about this race is Iowa has never elected a woman to Congress. So Joni Ernst, if she does win, will be the first woman elected from Iowa to Congress. She has stressed in her campaign advertising that she is a mother and a soldier. But really, gender has not played much in this race. And like in Colorado, Democrats have pushed some of the issues that they think would be effective with women voters. But really, this has come down to a base election where Republicans are energized about their candidate and Democrats are really trying to save Bruce Braley.
Okay. And in most base elections, at least in midterms, the turnout is not nearly as high. Is that the case here? Is it business as usual? Or do people recognize that the Senate's in play and are they coming out primarily for that contest?
Early voting has been going on in Iowa for 40 days, and the number of early votes cast this year sets a record for a midterm. 455,000 Iowans have already voted. That's about 40%. There'll be another 60% or another 600,000 or so who will vote today. So there is great interest in this race, and this really is the marquee race in Iowa. Mm-hmm. We have a governor's race that's hardly gotten any attention. We have a governor who's running for a sixth term. No attention paid to that race because of all the attention and all the focus on getting this seat in Republican hands for Republicans and in Democratic hands for Democrats.
Okay, before I let you go, we've got 15 or 20 seconds left. I heard you spoke with Vice President Biden today. How optimistic was he on this night?
It was fascinating because at the end of the interview, he said, regardless of which party holds control of the Senate, I think the message from the 2014 voters, he said, mm-hmm. was that they don't want people to go to Washington to do nothing. They want people in Congress to do something. So it's interesting to hear him say those things this close to the close of the polls here in Iowa, which will be closing in about 40 minutes or so.
All right. O.K. Henderson, the news director of Radio Iowa, joining us from Johnston. Thanks so much for your time.
Sure.
All right, Gwen, back to you.
Thanks, Hari. Polls have now closed in more than half of the states in the country. We have some projections for you. In the Texas governor's race, the projected winner is Republican Greg Abbott. He's defeating Democrat Wendy Davis, who, of course, came to, not unexpected, but she came to notoriety from her filibuster on the floor of the Senate. And in Minnesota, Senator Al Franken has won re-election. Of course, Senator Al Franken managed to win re-election by keeping his head down.
Well, isn't this, I was just going to say something about that. That was the closest race 6 years ago. We had a recount that it felt like months.
Yeah,
I mean, it was weeks and weeks
and
weeks. Yeah. And the fact that that can be called on closing says something, and you're exactly right. It says that he kept his head down and just focused on his job, and they were never able to crack him.
Stu, let's run through what we know so far tonight. What have you seen, and what does it tell you?
Well, we know the Republicans have picked up Senate seats in, I believe, South Dakota, West Virginia, and Arkansas. And I think we know that the focus continues to be on Iowa, Colorado, Kansas, Georgia, North Carolina. Well, nobody's called North Carolina. I've been looking at some of the North Carolina numbers, and they strike me as surprisingly good for Kay Hagan at this point. Now, again, nobody's called the race. I'm certainly not calling the race.
Thank you.
But when I looked at the numbers, I was surprised. And I did speak to a Republican within the last 20 minutes who said to me he was disappointed. He expressed disappointment. He said, it looks like we may not get that race that we thought we were going to win.
And that Republicans did not get Gene Shaheen. They saw that race tighten up over the course of the last few weeks, really thought they might have an opportunity there. You know, New Hampshire is a state that swings like a pendulum almost every 2 years, going with whichever way the wind's blowing. Republicans thought the wind's blowing our way, here's our chance. But that's another candidate in Gene Shaheen she's a former governor, very well positioned in a small state.
That said, the map still has a lot of up in the air, toss-up states which favor Republicans, right?
Absolutely.
That's right.
The Colorado just closed, and I was looking at some of the early exit poll numbers. Surprisingly, More men voted than women voted in Colorado. Mm-hmm. And remember, Mark Udall ran a whole campaign on personhood and cultural issues and abortion rights. And it looks like Gardner is rolling up considerable strength among men voters. I did want to mention one other race. We hadn't talked too many governor's races. The numbers, I'm watching the Florida governor's race where Republican Charlie Crist has about 126,000 vote. Sorry, I said Republican Charlie Crist.
Well,
Republican Governor Rick Scott has a 126,000 vote lead over Republican turned independent turned Democrat Charlie Crist with about 80% of the vote in. There were some Democratic portions of the state, the Gold Coast, that have not reported. So again, it's a very close race, but at the moment, Scott has a narrow lead.
What does that tell us? Anything extra?
I don't know if it tells us anything extra, except that this is a race that has been tight from the very beginning in a state that we are going to spend a lot of time in 2016. But this is a race that Crist won very narrowly in the his first go-round in 2010. If he wins in this case,
Scott won narrowly.
Gosh, keep doing this. Scott will win very narrowly. He could win very narrowly again, and it shows just what kind of a jump ball state Florida is.
You know, one of the things I'm always interested in looking at these exit polls is what happens with women voters, but not mm-hmm. just women voters, married
sure.
women
yes.
and single women.
That's right.
And we're showing in places like Georgia that married women are going and are going 47, 48. Not Purdue none, which means that's a dead heat among married women, and that among non-married women, none has a 8, 4, 5, 9-point advantage. It's really very interesting to me whether women, especially in races like Colorado, which was so heavily tilted toward women's issues, might decide this, maybe? Voters?
Well, I mean, I think you've hit on a really interesting point. We talk about various demographic mm-hmm. categories,
right.
but there are categories within the categories that yeah. sometimes tell us more about who's voting for who and why. And, you know, there are differences between married women or older women and single women and younger women. And in some senses, that's the fascinating part of the electorate. We don't spend enough time on that, I think.
One of the other things I'm always interested in also is about early voting, but we'll talk about that in our next go-round and find out whether that had any kind of effect
okay.
this time.
Okay.
Back over to Judy.
Thank you. And speaking of gender, and we like women and men around here, our political editor Lisa Desjardins has taken a look at why female voters are so critical and getting lots of attention.
In campaign land, it is the year of the woman.
I will always stand with our women.
I've helped women in the military.
We're taking our message to women voters.
I trust women to make their own decisions.
And if that's not enough for you, candidates are providing a slew of relatable women in their ads. Why all this female friendliness? The simplest reason, more women vote. In the past 5 midterms, women have outnumbered men nationally by about 5 million votes each time. And exit polls tell us some interesting things about how they vote. In 2012, married women were divided, voting 53% for Mitt Romney. But single women overwhelmingly went Democratic, with 68% supporting the president. Democrats want those women at the polls again this November. Hence these ads from Democrats.
Seriously?
Here's Colorado.
The only place Cory Gardner will take women's rights
is backwards.
And Michigan.
As a woman,
Terry Lynn Land should know better.
Republicans are fighting back with mixed success. This ad comparing voting to wedding dress shopping, that definitely did not work.
The Rick Scott is perfect.
But candidates talking straight to women, it might.
I believe the pill ought to be available over the counter, round the clock, without a prescription.
Congressman Gary Peters and his buddies want you to believe I'm waging a war on women. Really? Think about that for a moment.
One last note. Both parties have stepped up efforts to not just reach out to women, but to get more of them elected. From Georgia to Oregon, new female candidates are running for Senate. As a result, this new U.S. Senate could have a record number of female members. But before you think that women have closed the political gap, keep in mind that the record set by the current Senate is far from reflective of the population. Just 20 out of 100 senators are women.
And let's talk with Lisa right now. She's over there at the table with our political director, Domenico Montanaro. So, Lisa, tell us about some of the women who are running tonight and how they're doing so far.
Right. We're getting a first picture of what's happening. We have two prominent women of the Northeast winning. We've got Susan Collins and Jean Shaheen, who will both be returning to the U.S. Senate. But also out were two very prominent challengers, Terry Lynn Land in Michigan and Allison Grimes in Kentucky. I think what's going to be interesting, Judy, here is we have a record number of women in the Senate, as that piece just said. We don't know tonight if there will be more women in the Senate. There could be less. A lot will happen in Iowa, depending on whether they send Jody Ernst to the Senate or if Kay Hagan wins in North Carolina. Speaking about North Carolina, I want to touch on a point that Gwen brought up just a minute ago with Amy and Stu. If you look at the exit polls from North Carolina, Kay Hagan is winning with single women by 34 points, and she's also winning with single men. Her gap single versus married is larger than the gap female versus male. So we talk about things through this lens of gender politics to some degree, but in North Carolina, we see a larger split between married people of any gender and single people. So it's interesting too.
It is, and that's something we've seen before as we look at often they say single people more dependent, maybe more dependent on assistance from the government than married couples combine those incomes. Domenico, you are looking at where all these races stand right now. What do you see?
That's right. One of the things Lisa is mentioning about women, one of the women who was a flip tonight for one of those seats was Shelley Moore Capito, who you all have been talking about. And right now, let's take a look at where the score is at this point on the scorecard. We've got it 44 for Republicans, 42 for Democrats. And that means that we have three flips so far: West Virginia, Arkansas, and South Dakota. Republicans' magic number here, three seats. So still three seats left.
They're getting very close.
They're getting very close tonight. One of the races that we haven't heard about yet in this 9 o'clock hour that we're waiting on is Louisiana. And Mary Landrieu, who has been has a very famous political family in Louisiana with her brother and her father, one being a current mayor of New Orleans, the other a former mayor of New Orleans. And one county we want to look at in Louisiana to see how Landrieu might do is Jefferson County, another Jefferson County that we've been talking about throughout our coverage. This is in the suburbs of New Orleans, as you can see here. And in 2008, Mary Landrieu won it 52-46, and that very closely mirrored, actually, her results in 2008 and in 2002. Jefferson County could be one to really watch. Now, we all expect that this race is actually going to go to a runoff because you have three candidates here with Rob Maness, who's the conservative Republican challenger, to Representative Cassidy, who is the likely winner potentially in a runoff that would go December 6th as he leads in all the head-to-head polls against Mary Landrieu. And she just has not polled anywhere near 50%.
That's right. And expectation is, of course, the two, the Democrat and the Republican, not Maness, would be part of that runoff. All right. Domenico, Lisa, we thank you. Gwen.
Now joining us from Santa Barbara, California, is Jeff Greenfield, longtime political reporter and author and a contributor to PBS NewsHour Weekend. Hi, Jeff. Jeff was recently in Louisiana reporting on that neck and neck Senate race we were just talking about between incumbent Democrat Mary Landrieu and Republican Congressman Bill Cassidy. And you discovered an interesting thing that you reported on Weekend NewsHour, which is it's not quite the same thing as a federal race, is it?
Well, if in the sense that you mean it's not an election, it's a jungle primary. but the other thing that that's what they call it. And if this were an election, Mary Landrieu, who was supposed to finish first, would be elected. But because of the runoff, as you just heard, she's in serious political jeopardy. We've also learned by this, she's one of a series, and this is what I talked about in my piece, of prominent political families. You've already seen one fall tonight in Arkansas, where Mark Pryor, the son of a former governor and senator, has gone down a defeat. In Alaska, we've got Begich, we've got Udall in Colorado. And this, to me, helps define the national scene, and that these folks who have strong family ties to a state, they're all Democrats, are bucking this national, I don't know if it's a wave, a high tide, a summer shower, whatever it is, of anti-Obama sentiment. And I think all night we're going to be looking at whether those people can hang on based on their ties to those states.
Is it because people are voting on different issues at a state level than they are in federal races?
Well, yes. And I see what you're getting at. In this sense, what we may see is a tide nationally that all favors the Republicans in terms of the net gains. I think very few incumbent Republican senators or House members are in danger. Pat Roberts may be the only one. But at the state level, the discontent that is driving this whole campaign, the dyspeptic nature of the American electorate, more than two-thirds think we're on the wrong track, is being played out with incumbents in both parties. You've got something like 10 governors, Republicans and Democrats, who are facing very tough re-election. And I think that's because at the state level, people are taking out their anger on the people they see in charge. Whereas at the federal level, even though the Republicans control the House, they see Obama and the Democrats as the people they're angry about. So we might see something we very rarely see, a genuine bipartisan anti-incumbent feeling, depending on what level of the country you're talking about.
You know, Jeff, it would be helpful if you explain, walk people through the confusing nature of what it is that this runoff means. We may not know what's happening in Louisiana until January.
I'm sorry. Very simple, and you folks actually discussed it a little bit. Everybody's in the same race, Republican, Democrat, vegetarian. They all run in this primary tonight. If nobody gets 50%, and the expectation is nobody will, the top two finishers, and everyone assumes that's going to be Senator Landrieu and Congressman Cassidy, face off in a runoff. And what the polls are telling us is, under those circumstances, Cassidy looks to be the favorite. And as I say, it's to the Democrats' disadvantage that this is not an election, but a primary that's going to precede an almost certain runoff.
It's interesting because Mary Landrieu is one of, as you pointed out, she's part of a family of survivors, and she has survived runoffs before. But I wonder if, like in so many other states we've been watching around the country, the landscape hasn't changed.
Absolutely. Louisiana, which is very different in many ways, its food, its music, the fact that it admires convicted felons. Edwin Edwards is actually running for a seat in the Congress. But the one way it's similar to many other southern states, obviously, is that the once solidly Democratic state has moved steadily Republican. Mary Landrieu is the last surviving statewide Democrat. And the tide, particularly given Obama's unpopularity in Louisiana, is running very strongly against her. And her whole campaign is arguing, look, you know me, you know my family. And, by the way, I'm chair of the Energy Committee, and that's going to help our gas and oil industry. If the Republicans have taken the Senate already, then she is deprived of a major argument in the runoff because she will no longer be chair of the committee no matter what happens. So what happens tonight in terms of the control of the Senate could have a really serious effect on her chances for survival on December 6th.
We'll be at the edge of our seats. Jeff Greenfield, thanks for coming out to play with us tonight.
Always a pleasure.
Thanks. Judy?
Well, we don't know the final outcome tonight because it's just too early. But what we do know is that there will be a shuffle. And what we can share with you now is the White House has put out word that the president is extending an invitation to bipartisan congressional leadership to come to the White House to meet with him on Friday. Of course, that's an expectation that there's going to be possibly a different set of leadership in the House and the Senate. So we've been hearing about Louisiana. Another state we've been very much watching tonight is New Hampshire. That's a Senate race we've had our eye on. It's projected Democrat Gene Shaheen has won. We've made that projection. Hari Srinivasan is in our newsroom right now. He's been talking with reporters across the country. Hari.
All right. Thanks, Judy. For a sense of the scene in New Hampshire, we're joined by Carol Robideau of the Boston Globe in Manchester. Now, as you heard Judy said, it's 52-48 at the moment with about a third of the votes in, but there hasn't been a concession yet by Scott Brown. Is that right?
That's correct. What we're hearing from Brown's campaign is really everybody be patient and hang in there. We're going to celebrate tonight. Whether that's wishful thinking or not, it's hard to say. Given the way this race has gone, it's hard to say what's really going to happen. But I think it's pretty clear that Gene Shaheen has prevailed in this one. At least that's how it's looking.
Yeah, you know, a number of polls had said that Senator Shaheen was in danger tonight. But this race was called pretty early by a lot of us. What was the campaign able to do, at least even to get this kind of a lead at this point in the night?
I think that Jean Shaheen never took her eye off the ball. She was able to rally women in particular around a lot of issues that are most important to women, reproductive rights and birth control. And at one point in the campaign, especially when things started to tilt in Scott Brown's direction as he came on stronger, she really made a point to let women know that Scott Brown was not necessarily a vote for women's rights based on his previous voting record in Massachusetts. And of course, the carpetbagger label has stuck with Scott Brown, whether or not it's valid. I think that was a factor for some people. But ultimately, you know, I think voters here in New Hampshire are feeling pretty comfortable right now. Our unemployment rate is not too bad compared to the rest of the country. And so where in some states it might be people are looking to vote for change and they want something to happen. Here in New Hampshire, anyway, things haven't been so bad. The economy has turned around enough that I think people maybe voted for more of what's been happening, which is recovery.
Okay. Now, you've spoken to Brown's people. He's been campaigning for pretty much 5 years now. You had the special election in Massachusetts and the election versus Warren. If he doesn't win, what's next for him? I mean, obviously, they're expecting a win and they're still waiting for tonight. But what does he do next?
I don't know. I saw one reporter asked him if he would go back to Massachusetts if he lost, and he sort of just shrugged that off and said that's a silly question. I don't know what's next for Brown, but, you know, if he wants to hunker down here and rebuild a political career here, I think this campaign he came on pretty strong enough that maybe people will take another look at him in another election cycle. He certainly represents an independent voice and a moderate Republican voice, which is very appealing here in the Granite State. So being this close to somebody like Jean Shaheen, who is such a strong contender here in New Hampshire, that might give him encouragement to stick around and give it another try.
All right. Carol Robideau of the Boston Globe joining us from Manchester. Thanks so much for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Gwen, Judy, back to you.
Thank you, Hari. We turn again to Shields and Gerson syndicated columnist Mark Shields, Washington Post columnist Michael Gerson. We've been sitting here looking at some of these interesting trends of the evening, and among them is we haven't called a race yet in Colorado, but it's one of the states we're watching very carefully. And Michael, there are some interesting signs developing.
Yeah, there is. It is. It looks like that Udall is winning among women. But not enough to cover the gap among men. That's right now. It's not called. The race is not called. But it looks like that. The real question on this race that a lot of people had, including Democrats, was did Udall run a blue state campaign on essentially liberal social issues in a purple state, in a state that really was not as responsive to those issues? So I think that's a test. It was a high, he got tagged by the Denver paper for running a single issue campaign, Udall did, on liberal social issues.
Didn't that strategy work for Senator Bennett a few years ago?
I did. That is the question. Gardner doesn't fit the profile as well as Ken Buck did in the past. Gardner is a much more appealing character. Yes. The shoe didn't fit as well in this race.
I think that there's no question that Michael Bennett, the senior Democratic senator now, but presumably from Colorado, ran against his opponent and identified his opponent, and Ken Buck, who was more than willing to fulfill that role. And there's nothing more tempting in politics than to use something that is won once. I mean, there are still Republicans all over the country say, well, we'll just do what Ronald Reagan, we'll double the defense budget and cut taxes by a third. You know, there are Democrats who are trying to affect Jack Kennedy's mannerisms. I mean, it's a very derivative and imitative business. And I think Mark Udall got tagged by the Denver Post editorial board as Senator Uterus because of his emphasis almost exclusively on reproductive rights in their judgment. And this was hurtful for his campaign because it's a liberal newspaper.
But he tried to change that strategy. He did. As you got, Gwen, you were in Colorado.
I asked him about that. He said, right. Oh, no, we're talking about the economy. But in fact, the advertising that people were mostly seeing was about those issues.
And Cory Gardner was put a smiling face on conservatism. Yeah. He didn't fit that the stereotype. He wasn't complicit as that group of Republican
nominees.
He
called himself a different kind of Republican, which is what George Bush called himself in 2000.
I wonder what Michael thinks about a smiling face on a conservative.
Well, I'm all for it, actually. Yeah. But there are examples like John Kasich in Ohio and other places that did this, that took a strong conservative message and gave it a much more upbeat tone.
So. Okay, well, now we want to share some historical perspective on why today is Election Day. Political director Domenico Montanaro explains.
Tuesday. Unless you're a political junkie like me, your first thought probably is not Election Day. Most people are busy and at work. So how did this happen? Why do we vote on Tuesdays in November? Believe it or not, convenience. It dates back to 1845, when Congress established our voting day as the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November. Back then, we were largely an agrarian society. People lived and worked here. Not here, or here. There was spring planting and the fall harvest, so November it was. Okay, so why Tuesday? Religion. As a largely Christian country, most Americans went to church on Sunday, and Congress had to factor in travel time. It took a while to get to places back then. The car didn't come along for another half century. People drove these. And paved roads? Not exactly. Convenient polling locations at your kid's school were a thing of the future. Instead, Americans had to travel to the county seat to vote. But that's all changed, and some want to change when we vote to a more convenient day to fit modern society. The Weekend Voting Act, proposed in 2012, would move voting from Tuesday to Saturday and Sunday. But the bill, like a lot of things in Congress, died in committee.
That's funny, Domenico. Everything dies in committee, right? Well, it's good to know at least what the history is. And Stu and Amy, who are here with us tonight, they're best at it. Hey, listen, I want to talk to you guys about what happened in Texas tonight. Even though it wasn't a surprise, there was a moment in time in which Wendy Davis, who ran against Greg Abbott, who was elected tonight as governor of Texas, that she was considered to be the darling of Democrats across the country, and she was supposed to be the person who would turn Texas blue. It didn't happen. Why not? Stu.
Well, you're right. She was the darling of Democrats, and some Republicans might say also the darling of some in the media. Texas is simply a long way from turning blue. I think many of us believe that there are significant demographic changes that are taking place and will take place in the state over an extended period of time. But they haven't taken place in 2014. They're not going to take place in 2016. I don't know about 2020. But this is, there is still a very conservative element of the state that is not switching. And so, Wendy Davis is an interesting figure, interesting narrative, but she always had a terribly uphill climb. And frankly, Gwen, we always had the race at the Rothenberg Political Report as safe Republican. So, yeah, there was a lot of interest and media attention, but there wasn't anything there, frankly.
How about the Cook Political Report?
You're going to give equal billing, yes. Right? I think Stu's exactly right about the demographics in Texas working against her. And the same with the profile. I mean, her rise to fame was based on her success in beating back an abortion bill, and she was really identified very closely with that movement, and I think what it helped to do was to really gain her a lot of support nationally from liberal Democrats, raise a lot of money from liberal Democrats. In fact, she helped to raise a lot of money for the Democratic Party. But as a profile for the state of Texas, it was always going to be a harder hill for her to climb because she had to show that she was more than just the Wendy Davis who stood on the floor for the filibuster on an abortion-related bill, that there was more to her than that.
So based on what we've seen so far tonight, guys, what does it feel like the map is doing? Is it shrinking for one party and expanding for another, or is it too soon to say?
I mean, it feels like right now we are looking at sort of what we thought coming into this election, which was we knew that the red states were looking good for Republicans, and they continue to behave that way. Some of the blue states, we talked about New Hampshire going for Jean Shaheen, that doing better for Democrats. But the states that are still out are going to be tough ones for Democrats. There's some red ones, and then there are purple ones like Iowa and Colorado, where I still think that Democrats are going to have a tough climb to win both of those.
Well, let's talk about the tough climb and this time turn to Mark Shields and Michael Gerson and get some sort of sense about what you think is the tough climb. What are the issues that the outstanding state you're watching, the canary in the coal mine, the Rosetta Stone, whatever you want to say, that remains that you're watching right now, Michael?
Well, I think if Republicans don't take New Hampshire and North Carolina, in order to have a good night, they actually have to take Colorado and Iowa. Those look from the exits, like at least in Colorado, like serious possibilities. But that is, I think, you know, that would be a moderate wave for the Republican Party. It would show some strength in purple states, which I think they need to do.
Mark?
Yeah, what's interesting to me is the gender gap. I mean, if Gene Shaheen wins in New Hampshire, and if Kay Hagan does hang on in North Carolina, it'll be on the strength of women's votes. In both cases, they ran very strongly. And Mark Udall is, according to the exit polls in Colorado, running about 9 points ahead among women and being absolutely slammed by men. And I think Democrats have to look at it that they've got a gender gap with men. And I think that's a problem going forward, and it's certainly something that Hillary Clinton will want to think about as she prepares for a 2016 race. That gender gap, that she will be the first woman, is obviously an organizing principle or galvanizing. But I just think the gap in genders is fascinating, and we've always looked at it as an advantage to the Democrats because they had women. And I think there's a problem here as far as men are for the Democrats right now.
But hasn't that always been the case, Michael? I
mean, it is.
As long as we've been looking at the gender gap, going back to Ronald Reagan, the Republicans have done better with men.
But I would say that the risk for Republicans here is looking at this electorate and missing the vulnerability in 2016, just because it changes significantly. This is a whiter and older electorate by the nature. Republicans could have a message of complacency if they win the Senate coming out of this, when in fact they have serious work to do among younger voters, among minority voters, among rising demographics.
The voters, you're saying, who are not turning out in large numbers
midterm election.
As the older.
So it's a myth of a midterm mandate for Republicans, is they think that this confirms their strategy, when in fact they have significant electoral work to do to gain a national coalition.
It should be said we've gone this far tonight without ever mentioning 2016. So I'm very curious about what you guys see so far. For instance, you mentioned Hillary Clinton's problem with gender, and I wonder if you see any as you look forward now to 2016 and little signs you see.
I think Michael put his finger on a real problem for Republicans. After the 2012 loss of Mitt Romney, the Republicans went through sort of an open soul searching, you recall. Reince Priebus, the chairman of the party, was very candid. We have to support comprehensive immigration. We have to reach out to women voters. We have to figure out how to talk to and appeal to younger voters. Now, having done none of those things between 2012 and 2014, the Republicans are on the cusp of a great victory. So it strengthens and emboldens that group within the Republican Party that says, wait a minute, the problem we lost with Romney and McCain is we weren't conservative enough. We didn't really stand up. We don't need to change ourselves. We don't need to become touchy-feely. And I think that is a real problem for Republicans. We always misread what an off-year election is. 1958, when Eisenhower was crucified at the polls, it presaged that they wanted a change in 60. I mean, you could say that. And you look in 1998, it wasn't the case. I mean, Bill Clinton had a good 1998, and yet George W. Bush gets elected in 2000. So it's tough to draw, I think, a parallel. But I think there is a lesson here for the Democrats. And just on age, I'd point this out. When President Obama was reelected, 19% of the electorate was under the age of 30. That was the most Democratic, so the strongest support group of the entire age cohort in the population for President Obama. The weakest for President Obama, the strongest for Mitt Romney, were voters over the age of 65. Right now, we're looking at twice as many voters voting over the age of 65 in 2020. 14 as under the age of 30.
But,
and that's a problem for the Democrats tonight, but it's a problem for the Republicans in 2016.
And that's right, Michael, that was your point a minute ago, that this is, it's going to be a different, just quickly, that's a different electorate.
Yes, and both parties tend to overinterpret their mandates when they win elections,
right,
and instead of making the changes and adjustments that a victory would allow.
All right, before we go to, I want to go back to our political director, Domenico Montanaro, but we can tell you that it is projected that there will be a runoff in the state of Louisiana, that neither Mary Landrieu or Congressman Cassidy, Bill Cassidy, who is her Republican challenger, are going to get to 50%. That means there will be a runoff in the state of in the month of December. That and that means we may not know the makeup of the Senate until then.
It is significant that the third party candidate gets 11% of the vote. If that vote had gone to either one of them, they would not be having a runoff.
And there's a sense that most of it is going to go to Mr. Cassidy.
I think so. Sarah Palin came in and went for the third party candidate in this race. That made a difference.
Okay. Let's go to our political director, Domenico Montanaro. Domenico, you've been looking at some of the races that we've been waiting for. The polls have been closed for hours in Virginia, in Georgia. What's going on?
Well, what we've seen so far, I mean, if you look at some of the earlier states that we've been looking at throughout the night, Virginia, North Carolina. North Carolina, if we start there, this is a race that is very, very tight right now, within a point. You see 48-48, and you see the number of votes. Tillis up just a couple thousand votes with 55% of the precincts in. So we're going to, this one could come down to the wires. It's already shaping up to be.
And it's interesting to me that we saw North New Hampshire projected before my home state of Virginia, the Old Dominion. Virginia right now is a 49% for the Republican Ed Gillespie, 48% for Mark Warner, the incumbent Democrat. Now, of course, the trick with Virginia is that race comes in late sometimes. We saw this same split with our governor's race last year, and those numbers flipped in the very end. But we're seeing, obviously, some close races that perhaps some people thought would be called earlier have not been. And obviously, Georgia has not been called yet either.
We look at the 49-48 in Virginia. That race had been much further apart through the night. Now some of those northern Virginia counties coming in, and that's why it's tighter. Georgia, as you were seeing there, you know, we've got a potential for a runoff. Right. We have that third-party candidate who we just saw on our screen, Amanda Swafford.
And we're waiting for some of the counties around Atlanta to fully come
in. That's right. And I think one of the big-picture points here, though, to look at is the fact that Republicans, it looks like it's coming down to a very tight night right now. I mean, if North Carolina goes to Kay Hagan, if she were able to eke it out, in Virginia, Mark Warner is able to eke it out there, you know, then you're looking at Montana in the 10 o'clock hour here coming up, likely to go
right.
Republican.
So let's talk about those numbers that we just showed.
Right.
45 right now. That's where the Republicans are. They need five more seats. Some of those can even be incumbent Republicans in order to make it to 50. As Domenico was saying, we expect Montana could be one of those. That could be a flip. So it's just to say we're getting there,
right,
guys.
So you've got Montana, but then you've got Iowa, Colorado, still very tight races. And then Alaska at 1 o'clock. You know, this could be very, very tight as we watch all the races track out. Go ahead, Gwen.
Well, thank you very much, both of you. This is very interesting. It's been projected that Senator Mitch McConnell won re-election. What's still unclear is if he'll be the next majority leader, as we've been discussing, of a Republican-controlled Senate. Hari Srinivasan's in our newsroom with more.
For a sense of the mood at McConnell's campaign headquarters, we turn now to Paul Kane of The Washington Post, who's there and joins us. So you've listened to Mitch McConnell's remarks. Were they conciliatory, confrontational? One of the quotes that kind of stood out to me, and I didn't have a chance to hear the whole thing, was, "I don't expect the president to wake up tomorrow and view the world any differently than he does now. He knows I won't either."
Exactly. McConnell did a little bit of both tonight. He did sort of some reaching out, some like softening up himself. He brought Dr. Noelle Hunter on stage and talked about how he helped get her daughter back from West Africa after her husband had abducted her. And then he also talked about his bipartisan efforts in the past. He didn't mention Vice President Biden by name, but he said at one point, "I hope the president gives me the chance to do that again, to do deal making, but Boy, there were also some big, big partisan jabs that he threw at this White House. And at the very, very end, he turned it back to Mitch McConnell, the fighter, Mitch McConnell, the partisan that Democrats have always loathed so much. And at the very end, it was, this experiment in big government has lasted long enough. So really, Harry, he did a little bit of both tonight.
Okay, you've been following the campaign for the last few days. What was the turning point? What was he able to use to motivate so many people to get out there in this decisive victory?
You know, he really, really used President Obama incredibly effective as his foil. He just said over and over again, Obama needs Grimes. Kentucky needs McConnell. That was a line that he rolled out for the first time at the Fancy Farm Festival in southwestern Kentucky back in early August, and he just beat it into the ground over and over again. And in so many parts of Kentucky, President Obama is really unpopular. The coal country in eastern Kentucky, which has just been ravaged with thousands and thousands of job losses, McConnell is winning by margins that he's never won before there, and he's winning some counties that he's never won before, because those are really old, old Democratic counties in the sort of the last part of the South that really hadn't flipped. Well, those counties flipped tonight, and largely because McConnell ran against Obama.
Right, so was he able to make that case that there's this opportunity here, if the Republicans take the Senate, that one of the most powerful people in all of Washington would be from Kentucky?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the other thing that he really did. Democrats like to say that in the last three or four election cycles, they've really localized their races, made people have a sense of what their incumbents are all about. McConnell, in this race, over and over again, part of his stump speech was the part where he talked about the rare opportunity to have your home state guy be the majority leader. And he made it clear that it would help Kentucky, that he would be delivering votes to help the coal industry, that he would deliver the Keystone Pipeline, which, while it doesn't cut through Kentucky, it is something that they're familiar with here. He really made that sense of the connection of, look, this is going to be pretty good for Kentucky if we have me as majority leader.
All right, Paul Kane of the Washington Post, thanks so much for joining us.
Anytime, anytime. Happy to be here.
All right, back to the election desk.
Thank you, Hari. I think one fascinating what the reporter is telling you. There's another state that I think all of us are in a little bit of state of shock about, and that is Virginia. If we can put up those numbers, and this is with 93%, if I'm reading this correctly, the precincts reporting. Mark Warner, who was running for re-election after one term, who was expected to win easily against Ed Gillespie, former Republican National Party chair, former worked in the Bush White House, George W. Bush White House. Is ahead by a point over Mark Warner. We're here with Mark and Michael. Are you as surprised as I am?
I thought it was close in closing, obviously, and the fact that Mark Warner was running very strong negative commercials on television, a very heavy buy in the last 2 weeks against Ed Gillespie, was an indication that his own numbers were telling him that he was in trouble and that Gillespie had closed the gap, but it is a race that the Democrats never even considered to be in trouble. I mean, not the Kay Hagan, not the South Dakota or anything of the sort.
Let me ask Stu Rothenberg and Amy Walter over there, who've been digging through these exit polls first. I'm very curious about whether you see anything tonight which would have warned you, that would have been a warning bell about what we see happening in Virginia tonight.
Well, two things to remember. The first is we still have a lot of votes out in Northern Virginia, which is a Democratic stronghold. So Fairfax County, which is a place where Democrats traditionally do well, where Warner's doing well, you still got 40% of the vote out there. So I do think that this is still, we still have a ways to go, but I think that we have to wait until we see those numbers come in. The other piece about Virginia is I think there was a little bit of complacency. Look, there had been so much talk nationally about how important these 10 states were that we've been talking about on and on and on for the last few months here. Nobody had really talked about Virginia, and we can't forget that Virginia is a purple state. It is not a safe blue state.
It's true. And there's another state that's not very safe, and we were looking at some interesting exit polls, Michael, from Wisconsin, which kind of tells us, writ large, what we've been watching all night everywhere else.
Exactly. It looks like the percentages of men compared to women in that race are exact mirrors of one another. So 50, you know, these are just estimates, but 57-42 Walker winning men, 57-42 Burke winning women. It's like the boys versus the girls in a
race. But women like make up a bigger, slightly bigger percentage.
That would seem
of the
electorate. To be. But it's it just indicates some of this enduring divide in American politics. That I think both parties have to take seriously.
Yeah, what is it about the way women and men look at this differently? Stu Rothenberg, you're over there with Amy. I was wondering if you have any thoughts about some of these exit numbers we're looking at. We've been talking about gender, but what else are you seeing here in terms of income, in terms of race, or any other issue, or any other demographic, I should say, that helps us understand what's going on?
Well, we've seen Democrats doing some pretty good jobs in terms of getting out the African-American vote. But most of the demographics look very traditional, Judy, with Republicans doing better with upscale voters, Democrats with the more working-class voters. So there's nothing jarring there. I think it's mostly the fundamentals of the state. You have Republican states, Democratic states, and swing states. And they're behaving generally the way we expect that they would, except for Virginia, which is at the moment confusing.
We're glad you're being candid and honest about this. Stu
it
and Amy.
Is what it is.
And that is the News Hour for now. For this hour, stick with us as we live stream our live election coverage online. You can find it pbs.org/newshour. I'm Judy Woodruff.
And I'm Gwen Ifill. We'll be right back here for a special report at 11 p.m. Eastern. For all of us here at the PBS News Hour, thank you and stay with us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Lincoln Financial, committed to helping you take charge of your life and become your own chief life officer.
BNSF Railway. And by BAE Systems, inspired work.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.